What's up, road tripping fam? Ready to travel? Travel back to the West Side as Brooke and Evan bring us episode 96 with sports journalist and broadcaster Taylor Rooks. Dive into the next hour with the crew as you get to know Taylor, who works for Bleacher Report and Turner Sports, yet her path to current day is much more dynamic. Before I send it out to the crew, wanted to also inform you all, as many have been asking, Uninterrupted has us up and running with a link to the road tripping show, the Luke Walton episode, in its entirety. Head over to our Instagram page at Road Trippin' or at Road Trippin' Pod on Twitter for the link to take you straight to the episode. That's the Luke Walton Road Tripping Show episode, now on our social handles, Twitter and Instagram, for the full episodes to be watched. All right, back to episode 96. Brooke, take it away.
Thank you very much, Allie Girl. It is time for your favorite podcast, or at least I'm telling you it is, Road Trippin' with Brooke Olsendam and, of course, E.T. the man, Evan Turner.
Hey, how you doing, Brooke? What's going on? Today we got a special guest.
Yeah, I'll let you do the intro. I was going to.
I'm
going
to have to do the intro because I showed up yesterday. We're in New York right now.
Correct.
Went to Bleacher Report, did a few things, you know, and I bumped into a friend that we had tons of mutual friends in common, you know what I'm saying? So she came in, we were able to talk a little bit, and my buddy Jelani Foy was like, Evan has a podcast. You should hop on. I'm like, there's no way that's going to be possible. You know what I'm saying? Like,
she's too busy.
There's no way that's going to be possible. So I'm like, well, you know, if you want to go on like a dope podcast, I think you should show up. And I thought she's just going to Hollywood me, pump fake me. You know what I'm saying? She's booming out here. And she's like, no, legit, I'll do it. I'll do it. And it's legit probably 9 a.m. So she probably woke up at like 7. Took the train where all the...
And looks beautiful still.
Yeah.
Oh, I think,
and all the crackheads were probably out bothering her, harassing her and all that stuff. And she showed up for sure. Doesn't know me from Adam. Just knows we have mutual friends in common. And she showed up. And this is the amazing Taylor Rooks. Thanks for pulling up, coming.
Well, no problem. No problem. I love the subway, so it was all good.
Really? That's,
yeah. You love the subway.
Wait till December. Yeah. Wait till December. You tell me the same thing.
I didn't have to wake up at 7. Yeah. Popped up at 8, threw on some tinted moisturizer, put a hat on.
Okay. Look how you're doing it. Just Carrie Bradshaw style. Just making it happen.
And I have to say, I have to bring it up, that what did you have waiting for you when you arrived?
Yes. Let's talk about the host with the most.
Yes.
Evan Turner.
Setting the tone.
When he was asking me, like, okay, come at 9 a.m. He's like, I'll have coffee if you need it. I was like, honestly, I'll just take grapefruit juice and toast. I was kind of kidding.
Oh, you requested
it. But then he really
it.
Had grapefruit juice and toast.
Yeah, well, it's at least
with strawberry jelly, like we do it down south. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Then a straw.
So I appreciate it.
A straw for your grapefruit juice.
Which I did not ask about the straw, so he was really thinking
about
it.
Well, just so you know, straws are hard to come by these days, especially in Portland.
Yeah, they definitely are. I don't even, especially in Portland.
Well, and the West Coast is very anti-straw right now. I think there are actual, like, law. I mean, the laws are either coming or they're in effect where no straws. Then it has to be a...
Just to be more green?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Really?
It's a big deal.
And I don't think the dishwashers care about washing the dishes enough just yet for me to trust. The glasses, you know what I'm saying?
I hear what you're saying. Yeah.
I don't think if you don't have benefits at that job, I don't think
they're really caring.
They're really caring. So I think we need to pass a law about making sure dishes are washed two
sanitary
or three times, other than if you're gonna get rid of the straws.
Yeah.
Basically.
No, I definitely agree. But
I had a friend once that would bring her own silverware to restaurants.
That's extra.
That is.
That's a lot.
Well, because she would say, I mean, think about the amount of people that have used this fork and now you're using it. And then it kind of grossed me out. I didn't start bringing my own silverware, but I understood the premise of bringing.
I bet your friend didn't lead a house of 418. She did that. She for sure did not lead a house of 418.
She's definitely a big, like, germaphobe. So.
Yeah. I think Rajon Rondo was kind of like that, too.
Yeah. I've heard he washes his hands excessively.
Yeah, he showers like 5 times.
Yeah.
Rondo's a genius in his own right.
He's a basketball mind, right?
Yeah. Amazing Connect Four player.
Really?
Amazing Connect Four player.
Well, tell us how we know this.
Oh, because we went to a children's hospital, so you know, being adults, you don't see some of these games all the time. So eventually it goes from playing with the kids to be like, yo, little kid, move out the way. Get Rondo head up, you know? And Rondo was like, man, I could beat 3 of y'all at once. And he was legit doing it. Like, you know, and then he gets to talking, gets in your head. Started second guessing myself. What was supposed to be like a day of cheer turned out to be.
You're yelling at each other.
Meanwhile, if I know somebody, they'll see like a game of Connect Four sent to the phone. Like, let's get it. Like, you know what I'm saying?
That is hilarious.
So I can just, you know, just in case I ever bump into them and
That's so funny.
A Connect Four board around.
We got to get you like a travel Connect Four so you can have it on you at all times. Yeah, the small one.
Are you a mastermind in any games like that?
No, I'm a jack of all trades, master of none.
Okay.
But I can shoot the shit really well. So
yes, you can.
I can shoot the shit okay, very, very well. That. I'm very quick and witty on my feet.
Yes,
but
you know this.
If we play Connect Four, I'll probably get y'all up out of here easily.
Can you play spades?
Yes, I can play spades.
No, that hesitation. You can't play.
No.
That's how I know. If somebody even thinks for a minute, a real true spades player is like, yes,
I don't,
I'm the best.
I don't like pressure from my teammates. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, damn, you were near. Damn, how many yes. did you get? Like, bro, relax. We in public. Take it easy.
Okay. No, but like spades is that serious. No. I do not like playing people with spades that do not know how to play.
I'm going to keep 1,000 with you. When I was 7 or 8, my grandparents used to watch me.
Mm-hmm.
You're busting the spades game open. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm not saying I was amazing, but I was good enough and the mind was thinking. You
yeah.
know what I'm saying?
To make it work.
Yeah, but you know, I haven't played it consistently to say I'm cold.
Can you play spades?
I was just gonna say, I'm so embarrassed to jump in here, but I have never played spades.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Is it a card game?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh no, so you don't even know what spades
no,
is.
I've got no clue.
Let's dial it down.
I'm
so
sorry.
Are you good at Uno?
Oh, I'm the queen of Uno.
That's what everybody says. So they get hit with 8 reverses.
Yes.
5 skips.
I'm
a
nasty
draw
4. At
Uno's. Oh, I turn up when it comes down. When I start, skip, draw 2,
ew,
draw
stupid.
4, reverse. Like, I get so hyped.
See, I enjoy like word games more. Like, I will kill you in Taboo or Catchphrase, Trivial Pursuit. Like, that
you're
is where
a true
I
adult.
Live. Yeah.
Like,
I love
of humanity,
games like that.
Games of Humanity, that type of stuff. Or wait,
oh,
cards
Against
cards?
Humanity.
Yeah.
I play that, yeah. But no, there needs to be some type of skill to it. Like, I will say a word and I will get you to know the word. Like, I'm just very good at
that's
that type
crazy.
Of stuff.
Andrew, so we did Cards of Humanity, me and Iguodala and Mustafa Shakur.
Oh, I would have loved mm-hmm. to.
It's like three. Oh, yeah,
that.
We can only imagine. Like, with just like 3 or 4 years ago on vacation, little mm-hmm. Cabo area. Mm-hmm. Andre knows how I do it. And we played Cards of Humanity.
Cabo.
And I remember almost losing my relationship over that. Like, come on, bro. Get your shit. Like, you know what I'm saying? Get your shit together. How do you? Oh, my fault. But you know what I'm saying?
Okay,
but
it's
like,
your podcast, YouTube.
Yeah, but it's like,
say what you want.
Like, get your stuff together. How do you not know that? Like,
you got really
and
bad.
And then we're like, let's play Uno. What's Uno? I mean, I was about to go back to America by myself.
But games are that serious. Like, my ex-boyfriend, we stopped playing games together because we would get in legitimate fights about it. Like, because I don't like to lose, and if you're dropping the ball, I'm getting mad. Yeah. I just...
That's nothing.
It's not good for
me. Man, at the last family reunion, my brother beat me at Madden.
Yeah.
The family reunion was 4 days. Nobody had an Xbox. So took it home. Unplugged it, took it home, went home with my stuff. They still talk about it, but
you
gotta have class when you beat me for sure.
So that made me think of something. So when you talked about your Cabo trip with other guys from the league, how do like? Well, first of all, before we even get to that, let's talk a little bit about Taylor's background, right? For those of you that don't know, and then we'll get to the Cabo trip because I do
hear about me.
Yes,
they
do.
Want to hear about Taylor?
But no, they want to hear about.
No, they want to hear about you. That's for sure.
Well, let's start with Taylor and talk about where we started, Big Ten, and now your big things are happening for you. So mm-hmm. just kind of humble brag a little bit, if you will.
So I went to University of Illinois, which I think is the... Chill out, okay? We almost beat Gonzaga. I know no one cares about
crazy.
Almost, but last night
there was that time.
That's a big night.
One time last night at the Maui Invitational, which we lose every year. But yeah, so I went to University of Illinois, and then from there I graduated and started working in Chicago at the Big Ten Network.
Mm-hmm.
Wanted to do a little more for myself. Wanted to do more than just like be on BTN Live and be on the show 10 minutes at a time.
Yeah.
So I decided to come to New York, where I hosted, anchored, reported with SNY, which is like the NBC here.
Yeah.
And then I just started at Bleacher Report about 2 months ago, and we're in pre-production for my own show,
that's
which
so
I'm
cool.
very excited about. It's going to be an interview-based show. So yeah, that's the little synopsis
the short version
of me.
So,
yeah,
that's exciting.
So how'd you choose, like, in sports? Like, how did you know you wanted to be in the sport world? Like, did you ever play any type of sports?
No. So in high school, I did run track. Okay. And I did volleyball a little bit. But I mean, I wasn't like Jackie Jordan or Kersey or anything like that.
Shout out Flo Jo.
So I decided to just talk about it. Yeah. And when I got to college, I started a blog. It was called The Online Sideline. Such a lame name looking back on it. But you know, it worked for me at the time. And it was really just a lot of hustling, a lot of emailing people. I would try to interview whoever I could, whether it was a manager on the basketball team or like the assistant coach or the guy that used to coach, you know, and just try to get better. And I remember it was my sophomore year and I was like, okay, I need to do more than just like what I'm doing in Illinois. And so I was hounding people at the NBA, like emailing, calling, saying, I really want to go to All-Star Weekend and do interviews. Yeah. Like, they're never going to credential me. Like, this little 19-year-old in Illinois wants to go to the All-Star game. I sent so many emails, they credentialed me.
Wow.
So me and a friend drove to Orlando for All-Star Weekend.
Bro, was that 2012?
It would have been, 2012.
Actually, I was there that weekend.
Oh,
that was
either 2011 or 2012.
No, for sure. If it's in Orlando, it was Orlando. That was that was a crazy weekend.
Was it? See, I was like, I didn't really know
anyone. She's like, I was working.
I just did my interviews.
That's ill.
But that was the first time that I had really interviewed, like, stars. You know, I interviewed, like, LeBron and Kobe and Kevin Durant and Derrick Rose and... It's, you know, you look back on some stuff and you cringe, like the way your voice sounded, the question you asked are just so stupid. Yeah. But that's a part of it. That progression is a part of it. You should look back and think you were bad, because if you don't, that means you didn't get any better at that point in this point in time. Mm-hmm. But I think that was when I said, okay, I can really do this. Like, I went down there and I fit in and I asked my questions and I felt good about it and I told stories. And it kind of took off from there.
That's so cool. I mean, that's hustling. It's starting at 19. Like, I was just chilling in college. I was like, what am I going to eat for dinner? Like, that was all I was thinking about when I was 19.
Yeah, or to drive from Illinois to Orlando.
It was long. It was really long.
Who was your friend? Because that was a great friend to do.
Yeah, it was my friend Kevin. And then we dropped
Kevin
to Georgia.
Wash?
Yes, Kevin.
Yo,
you know Kevin?
Walsh.
Oh, here we go.
Look at all these friends.
Yeah, Kevin Walsh. You know Kevin? Yo, that's my man.
Yes, yeah, so
he
me
did
my
a lot of
Kevin
basketball.
Drove.
He's crazy, like basketball. Like,
so he was like, yes, let's get credentialed. Let's go.
Yeah,
he was
shout
the
out to Kevin
best
Walsh.
Person to ever go. So, and then we, on the way, I'm from Georgia, so we stopped at my home, picked up my friend Samantha, and we all went.
What a fun trip.
Yeah. It was a good time. Like, and I always think that just with Cabin, me and him both knew that we loved sports. We were doing whatever we could in college to just, like, break into that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Good times. Good times.
Man,
it's
dope,
so funny,
man.
You know Cabin.
No, I mean, well, Cabin always used to hit, I feel like always used to hit me up for interviews and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, no. Yeah. But I always remember him, my boy Daniel Poneman, who's
Swag Air. What was his name?
Yeah, so him and my friend Jelani Floyd, they run a sports agency together.
That is hilarious. You work with Daniel? That is amazing.
Oh, by the way, Jelani's here, everybody, if you're wondering
Jelani
who we're talking
Floyd,
to.
Shout out Jelani.
He's sitting on the floor behind us.
One of my good friends from
childhood.
Well, the
thing with Daniel and Cap, so when I was in college, the thing that really, really, like, was my bread and butter was recruiting. Mm-hmm. I covered recruiting, and I would break people's recruitments.
Mm-hmm. You did a lot of stuff with scout.com, right?
I did.
Yeah.
Oh, that's ill. Scout was legit.
Yeah, so it would get into... Like, I would get in situations where the players would tell me where they were going before they announced, and they'd say, okay, I'm going to commit today. This is where I'm committing. You can say it. So then people started following me to figure out, like, where these Chicago kids were going to commit to. And so then, like, buzz started around that, and I would start to get really good interviews, and then I started working with the Big Ten Network in college. And when I graduated, it's funny. Like, people always think that, like, you're going to have everything figured out in college, or if you don't have a job when you graduate, you're never going to have a job. Yeah. But when I graduated, I didn't know what I was doing. I was about to move back home at the end of the summer. But my last thing I was doing before I went home is we were going to go to a Drake concert. Me and my friends were going to a Drake concert.
Good night then.
Yeah,
right,
yeah.
Right before you go back to mom's house.
Yeah, it's like, we're going to go to a Drake concert.
The highs and the lows.
Yeah. And you silly. And on the way back from the Drake concert, this is 2 days before moving back home, jobless, like going to move back in the basement of my mom's house, Big Ten Network calls. And it was like, we would like you to come work with us like 5 days a week and do this show. But up until that point, I'm like, oh my God, I worked this hard and I'm not going to have a job when I graduate. So things just happen and you just have to trust in the timing of those things happening. So
that's true.
Yeah. Oh, I think so too. I definitely think when it comes down to it, when you play with skill, good luck will happen in a sense.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I think I always tell kids, like, hey, bro, like, even if you don't want to wake up and take that bus ride somewhere, mm-hmm. it's going to pay off. Like, yeah. you're going to put your penny in the bank. Yep. You're going to do all that stuff. And it's going to pay off eventually. Like, you know what I'm saying? I always thought I would take buses all over the city just for a better opportunity to go hoop and be seen. And, you know, I didn't know what I was, like, how I was going to end up. But I thought, like, it's not going to happen if I don't.
You'll never regret being proactive. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. But you will regret not being proactive.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Of course, because I think anytime you want to do something crazy or, I guess, rare, you got to act in that manner all the time. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? How many people would have showed up and drove all the way down? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Keep emailing, you know what I'm saying, and shine the dark. And then, you know what I'm saying, then have that opportunity and then keep grinding from there. You could have rested on your laurels and...
Mm-hmm.
You feel me?
And then it's true.
It's not like, I already got to my part where I wanted to get to. You kept, you know, kept knocking on those doors and you keep doing it. So
I always tell people, for what we do, I'm talking for Taylor, is that I will never regret, and it sounds like you do the same thing, making as many connections as you possibly can.
Yes.
Like, when you meet somebody, you remember their name. The next time you see them, hello, how are you? Email, you know, if you can just reach out to as many people as possible and be genuine about it. You know, you want to, and I'm always like, if someone does a favor for you in this business, follow up with a thank you.
Yes.
And say,
I send thank you cards.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. That's the best thing. I think, like, no one does it anymore.
Yeah.
But that's the biggest thing. And then those, because this is such a small world, the TV business, especially sports television, that I've said this before too. Like, let's say someone that's interning for me, or let's say, or interning for my company, or the Blazers, in 5 years they could be an EP at a station I'm interviewing for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so you treat everyone well, which you should in general, but then just continue to make those connections. I think that's the biggest thing in our industry.
Sure. Yeah, I think the overarching thing just in general is just, it's so simple, but everyone should just be good to people.
Totally.
You know, it's, and I think that is something that we don't do enough. Just every single person, life is already so hard, mm-hmm. and like the world is already shit, that like you shouldn't encounter that with the people that you see every day.
Yes.
You know, so I just always try to be as nice as possible to any person that I meet, because we shouldn't be adding on to that for
totally
one another.
Yeah. You want to improve some, like, that's kind of how I approach life too. You want to improve somebody's day. If you meet them, if I'm having a bad day, I almost overreact to that and try to like, I don't ever want to put myself on someone else. Like, just so you know, I'm having a bad day. Mm-hmm. You try to say, okay, I'm good. Put it aside. I'll deal with it. But I don't want it to affect other people.
No, that's like my AAU coach. He's like my mentor, Mike Mullins. He always said, if you ever like too deep into your own worries, like legit get up and go make somebody else smile.
That's good.
Yeah.
He's like, not many people are going to feel bad for you. And at the end of the day, you're tough enough to like persevere and push through. So I think that's just a great, you know what I'm saying, recipe for life in a sense. And obviously, it bodes well because you both, I mean, like I said, we met like 12 hours ago, and then you wake up at the crack of dawn for me and the homies.
Crack of dawn.
And now we're about to go global because of Taylor Rooks. So I think next we might have to get to top this. We got to get somebody.
I don't know if we can.
This is second episode.
Yeah, it's silly. Well, you guys have a lot in common. Like you said, you have a lot of people that you know, but Chicago is something that you guys
the best city
in the world.
It
for sure.
really is. I miss it.
And don't
I'm
let
going
it get
65
degrees.
Yes.
Because it's going to be crazy.
It is popping. Yeah. I'm going next week for my best friend's baby shower.
Oh, that's dope.
But most importantly, I'm going to get some Harold's.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Yeah, I got to get some Harold's chicken.
Okay,
got to go to Sunda.
Okay.
Got to go to Batter and Berry's, you know, got to hit all the spots.
You busting the moves, huh?
I love Chicago. I miss the food. Like, I think it's the best food.
I'm going back Wednesday
city.
Night.
Really?
By far. So I hate when people, like even chicken wings. People are like, you want some wings? Like, no, I don't want wings.
Like,
because the wings.
You got some mild sauce?
Yeah. People are, you know what I'm saying? Or like the pizza. Like, I enjoy pizza. It's my favorite.
Same.
But it's like, you go else. Only in Chicago they do it right, in my personal opinion. Portillo's.
Now listen, I love Chicago.
Oh, no.
I love Chicago food. Not
only good pizza.
I don't
place
think
out
that
here.
Chicago pizza is the best though. It's like a casserole.
I'm not talking about deep dish.
But that's what you go to Chicago for. You go
that's
to Chicago
thinking,
to get deep dish.
No, that's a myth. Like, I didn't start eating deep
Where
dish.
Do y'all get your pizza
Where
from then?
You can go to Home Run Inn. Home Run Inn's like a local chain.
Wait, is that that's like kind of in Wrigleyville?
Home
like
Run Inn's all over. It's all over.
Oh, okay. There's
and
one
then if you want thin crust, you can do Giordano's. Any hole in the wall in Chicago, thin crust is going to be legit. I didn't start eating deep dish up until I met Sam and Escalco.
Really?
And I used to be at his house. We met when we were 16. I probably didn't eat deep dish till I was 16, 17 years old.
But I'm saying, even if you don't eat deep dish, like, deep dish is synonymous with Chicago. That's when people think Chicago yes. pizza Absolutely. Versus New York pizza, yeah. they think deep dish versus
That's when
thin
you
crust.
Know you're an outsider, when you're a local.
I'm an outsider. when you started talking about it, I assumed you were talking about deep dish.
Oh, no, of course yeah. not. Never. And I never talk like, I feel like deep dish is just like
Lasagna.
No, it's just fine cuisine. Like, when you go get pizza, you wear this. When you go get deep dish, you're dressing up. It's no different. It's just a.
And use a fork and a knife.
Yeah, it's fancy Italian dish. Yeah. But, I mean, that piece is like $30 a piece. Who got time for that? Like, yeah. You know what I'm saying? But, like, no, I'm talking like, when you go back, home run in, or get, you know, the Giordano's thin crust, if you do want to do deep dish, mm-hmm. do Lou Malnati's. You know okay. what I'm saying? And just keep it simple.
So I didn't know people did that. I may do that.
That's crazy. Man, you must have been hanging out with other outsiders. And well, Portillo's is a must for
Chicago,
sure.
Chicago, I love. I mean, I love visiting there, but I have not spent nearly as much time as you guys. Yeah. Other than the food, like, what is, like, the vibe of Chicago, would you say?
I love Chicago because it's a city, but you still have a homey feel.
Yeah.
I lived in the West Loop, and, like, everything is also a lot closer. My first year when I moved there, I wasn't used to, like, having a lot of money. So I thought I had to get an apartment that didn't cost that much. So I had this tiny studio in Wrigleyville. It was like $800 a month, okay?
That's a steal.
Yeah, but it was like 2 miles from where I needed to be, which was the heart of the city.
Yeah.
Like, just everything, even if, like, here, if you're in Manhattan, but then if you're in Queens or Brooklyn, it's far.
Yeah. yeah.
But in Chicago, if you're living downtown, but you're in Wrigleyville or Lincoln Park, you could walk if you wanted yeah. to. Like, it's not that far.
Yeah, it's on community for sure.
Yeah, Chicago's a huge community. It feels like a home. There's a river running through it. Someone once told me it's like New York without the New Yorkers. And I kind of feel that
no,
way.
No, it's for sure. I mean, in the Midwest, people are definitely very, very nice people.
Welcoming.
Very, yeah, very welcoming.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, you know, you don't really... You walk down the street and people say hello.
Yeah.
like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't until I hit the East Coast where that was kind of a foreign thing, I feel like.
Yeah. It's also clean. Chicago and Toronto yeah. remind me a lot
Toronto.
Of each other.
Yeah, Toronto is exactly like yeah.
Yeah.
I think the mayor, Mayor Daley, the former mayor, obviously, Rahm is on his way out. But mm-hmm. I think they did a great job because when I used to live in Philly, the downtown area was just dirty and just terrible. So... How we do, like, the presentation of Chicago, I'm definitely proud when I bring people there. Like, yo, this is mm-hmm. it. The Lakeshore Drive, Navy Pier.
Yeah.
Magnificent Mile.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Lincoln Park. And it's a lot of culture. A lot of culture. It's kind of segregated by a lot of culture, for
It
sure.
was really hard for me to leave. Like, I almost didn't take the job here because I did not want to leave Chicago.
Wow.
I didn't want to stop covering Big Ten sports. I love how sports fans are in the Midwest. I love Chicago. But I just didn't want comfort to be a reason why I didn't progress. You know? So I said, okay, I'm going to New York, where I never wanted to go. The two places I never wanted to live are New York and L.A. But I'm happy I did it because now I'm obsessed with New York.
No, it's dope. I feel like everybody should, like I said, should have that Carrie Bradshaw.
Yes.
Type.
Yeah. Do you
walk,
put your
walk the streets?
Listen,
the
I
hustle.
Am living
yeah.
single in New York.
That's what I'm saying. The hair just
the hair's going crazy.
Yeah, just flat out flowing
you're,
in the
you're
wind.
You're picturing Carrie.
Yeah,
yeah, in trouble.
Running down Central Park
in a tutu, you know,
trying to get a taxi. Like,
yeah, all that type of stuff. On the weekends, you go out with wine with your friends.
Yes.
And,
I
martini.
Definitely
do that. Yeah, martini bars, and you just
give
do your
a Cosmo.
Thing. Like, yeah, like
yeah.
That's the vibe.
That's
of
what
it.
I picture too, and that's what I was telling you guys before we started this. Is that we talk about traveling or not traveling. But moving so much in our jobs mm-hmm. in TV and in sports and TV in general, that I always had this dream that I wanted to live in New York just at least 1 year. Mm-hmm. I never got the chance, but I did. It was probably, I think it did stem from Sex and the City.
Yeah,
it has to be. I wanted to put my sweaters in the oven because I didn't have anywhere else to put them because I was living in the tiniest little apartment. Yeah, I wanted to have like 1,000 pairs of shoes. I wanted to take the subway. It would be so glamorous in my mind. I don't really think it is that way in real life.
Yeah. But hey, listen, the subway is
it.
Glamorous.
Yeah. But yeah, you have all these visions of living in New York City, and mm-hmm. that's why I thought I'd just automatically be cooler.
I think you really do become like a different person in New York, mm-hmm. and not in a bad way, but just you learn a lot about yourself. You learn a lot about how you react to certain situations. You know, when people say if you can survive New York, you can survive anywhere, yeah. I really believe that, because New York weeds people out.
You'll be
here for a year and be like, this isn't for me, yeah. and you'll leave. But you learn what you can go through and what you can't. But it's funny, just like I just hear you saying that you always wanted to live in New York and then you didn't, but the way you feel like you can't live in New York now, but you have so much life that you could live in New York for a year, but we've put ourselves in these like kind of parameters, like, well, the time I was supposed to live in New York was my 20s, so now I can't. But that's just something we make up in our head.
That's,
you know,
very
you could
true.
Always no, live in New true. York
gosh,
for a year.
That is a great lesson.
But I mean, if you want to pay $4,200 for a 700 exactly. square foot and have 100 shoes and do all that and 3 cats and not be known,
I never said I wanted cats.
And not be
that
known
is not
as
the
a
New York
weirdo,
style.
Then,
he
then
put that on you. You didn't say anything about cats.
And then pull up. I think that'll definitely work.
Why you gotta do me dirty? See, I don't want cats.
I'm just saying, just make sure you're ready for it, because ain't nothing cool about it. If you can make it.
What does cat signify? Does cat signify like single woman?
Yes,
in
it
New
does.
York?
When men is think that, single woman, they think
yeah,
cats.
Yeah, they think cats because you're lonely. Is that why?
Yeah, but I mean, I feel like a cat's the best thing too. But
no.
Because like also, they take care of themselves. So when it comes down to it, it's like you just want somebody there. Okay. Like a dog, you're too busy. You're too busy hustling.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay, I see where you're going.
Oh my gosh, I never want to get to the point where my comfort is my cat.
Nope.
And my
I know. Just,
but I'm a dog person, so it would never.
Yeah, I'm a dog person too.
Yeah.
So I have a cane corso.
Okay.
Italian mastiff, but he's in Ohio with my mom. But he's.
See, I have a white lab in there in Georgia with my mom.
Okay, yeah, he just turned 7. Brutus. Shout out to Brutus. 120 pound cane corso.
Shout out Lila. If she's listening, I don't want her to think
yeah,
about it.
Yeah.
Shout
sure
her out.
Shout out. No dog. I've got no dog.
So we're talking TV shows and we were arguing before we started taping. So
yes.
Oh, yeah. Let's get to
so
that.
So you guys were talking about Sex and the City earlier. Mm-hmm. You also said, what else you saying? You
we
like?
Said,
my
no,
favorite.
We,
oh, go ahead.
No,
go ahead.
Well, we were saying that we like, well, we are not a fan of Entourage.
Yeah, but me and Jeff, shout out to Jeff.
Jeff Curtin.
They said they only seen a few episodes.
No, I've seen a lot of episodes.
Look, so I think, of course, what'd you categorize
I categorized Entourage as a pornographic show with some guys just like shooting it. Like just having fun,
shooting the shit. Shooting it. It's just like
all right, be careful.
You're life
in New York.
Day.
That's where they're from, Queens. So just be careful. But
I'm just saying that the storylines were like, I don't need like a deep show, but I'm just saying it was a lot of TNA for no reason.
All right, yeah. I mean, well, the first two seasons, I believe they definitely showed the glamour of it, but I feel like the third season, fourth, fifth, when Vinny was going through his trials and tribulations and things like that. I think it became an amazing show. I watched it nonstop every day for like 2 years.
But I think guys like that show because it's either A, indicative of their life, or it's B, a life that they wish
totally.
That they lived.
Damn. That why is, can't it just...
Why can't
they just
life,
be a fan of
or
HBO
you wish
productions?
That you lived that life. I'm a fan. My favorite show of all time is HBO show. The Wire is my favorite show of all time.
The Sopranos
all time.
Ill.
Love Sopranos.
I don't think... I'm going to tell you the truth. I learned a lot, and this sounds like some BS, but I learned a lot about the movie business, or what could have happened in movie business. And I was kind of ignorant in the sense of like, oh, it has to be easy for everybody. So I'm thinking about Leonardo DiCaprio. I'm thinking about Will Smith. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The top guns. But there's a lot going on with it on top of, I thought, hey, man, Vinny Chase was the man. Like at the end of the day, the complexity of what he was doing, who he was as an individual.
Yeah.
And to live a Vinny Chase lifestyle in your 20s.
I'm sure it's accurate.
Yeah, it's American. I mean, not an American dream, but you know what I mean. Like, it's come on, that's young. You roll with your homies, you're working hard.
He's looking at us right now.
You're rolling with your childhood. I thought it symbolized what you could become, or like, you know.
No, but that's what I'm saying.
That's why
people
in a positive like in a positive manner. So like, Vinny was from Queens.
Lots of boobs and
butt.
Nothing. Yeah, I'm just.
Vinny's
so
from Queens. He had all the homies who live in L.A. They knew they weren't supposed to be there. Everything they were doing was just like, damn, like, can you believe we're here? And they took risks to keep going. And
I agree.
Like you live and then. You know, of course, the fast life comes with it, but you tell that story when you're 70, babysitting your grandkids, saying, hey, back in the day I did this, or back in the day I did that. But that's one of my favorite TV shows, along with The Wire.
Okay, so you do like The Wire?
Yeah, I love The Wire. That's a dope show.
Did you like Breaking Bad?
I'm going to keep it 100 with you.
You haven't seen it.
I'm so
goodbye.
We're done.
But I'm so impatient. I gotta wait. I have to wait until the series is over, and then I'll watch it in bulk. Like, I just started watching The Office last week.
Oh, what?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Is it not the best show ever?
I have to get off of this.
No,
the Office is the.
Yeah.
I mean, So I
like this, I know line for line The Office. I'm obsessed.
So I think that Breaking Bad is the best drama ever. And I think The Office is the best comedy ever.
Wait, have you seen The Wire?
No, I was going to say, everyone says, I have not seen one episode.
Because so I think you may like that more than
everyone
me.
Says
I
that
love
too.
The Wire.
That's okay, so you just started The Office, I'll start The Wire.
Yeah,
okay.
Start.
But The Office is, the reason I love it is, first of all, they do so much improv, which we don't even know what
yes.
is improv and what isn't.
Yes. Yeah, some of the crazy. Best scenes were improvised.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
the Oscar kiss.
Yes.
Oscar didn't know Michael was going to kiss him.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if you're there yet.
I like the wedding. I saw the wedding when they got married.
Yeah.
And they did the reenactment yes. of the YouTube thing.
Yeah.
I thought that was so dope. Because, like, bro, that's something I would truly do.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, if I ever get married, definitely want to steal that. Like,
yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
On top of.
Oh, look at you thinking about your wedding.
Oh, no, of course, man. Definitely. I'm seeing a lot of chicken fingers at the reception.
That is my number one thing. At my wedding, the food better be good and the music better be good.
And that's what people, honestly. That's what your guests really care about. I mean, of course, they're like happy for you and stuff.
Yeah.
But they talk about the food. They talk about is it open bar and is the music
yes.
good?
Yes. And I would really not go to a wedding that is not open bar.
I went to one.
Depending on the relatives.
Well,
depending on relatives. Not everybody can have open bar now.
No, that's true. Well, you see, isn't it funny how for some odd reason, people at weddings, they're like, there's no rules. It's a free for all. I'm just going nuts. It's like wedding receptions. People just go crazy.
No, that's for
yeah.
sure.
And they just like, okay, well, I need open bar. I need to drink all the drinks. And then they
yeah.
start. This guy that you've never heard a word from is out there like jamming to James Brown. And you're like, I didn't even know that guy could talk. And now
yes.
he's out there breakdancing.
I go to weddings and I wait for that one song. It's at the black weddings, but you know that
yes.
one song. What do you get up to? You get up to do the electric slide.
Oh, you yeah. do get up for electric
the
slide.
The electric slide, that's
the one?
That's the one.
Always.
That's my jam.
Everyone's got to get up for that?
Everybody's
I know, I'm
going to
be up for that.
That.
I'm going to be up for You went to
I
Myers Leonard's wedding, right?
Yeah. I went. I was at Myers' wedding. Myers
slide?
And I went to college together.
Yeah, of course.
We've been good friends for a while. I also went to Sam Decker's wedding. We've been good friends
oh,
for
man,
a while.
That's crazy. Some big 10, big
yeah,
10 notables.
Yeah, we are big tenors over here.
That's crazy.
But it's funny. I haven't been to that many weddings. I think I've been to 4 weddings, and that was 2 of them. And then my best friend got married.
Really?
Yeah.
What's the best, like, okay.
And then I went to Harrison Barnes' wedding.
So you've been to some weddings.
Some weddings.
No, those are the 4.
Really?
Yeah, those
That's
are the 4
more than
weddings.
I've been to. What's like the...
you haven't been to any weddings?
No, I've been to like people that you don't care about.
Oh, okay. I'm like, wait a minute.
I was going to be like, well, my friend Jackie got married. Why don't you care about that? No, I've not been to any, like, you don't know any of them. But I want to know the, like, of celebs or players or whatever, like the best wedding you've been to that we would know.
Yeah.
Andre Iguodala, the year they won a championship. I remember he had it at the one and only Cabo, in Cabo.
Oh, we're back to
Cabo.
Cabo. I know.
Dre loves Cabo. We just do trips there together with our significant other, not just us two. But I remember he just doing a destination wedding, and I remember him being like, hey, like 98% of people RSVP say they're showing up, and it was... It's a classy wedding. I was in a wedding.
Oh, were you?
It was crack. I got carried out. Now, I was a dude that night. I was fasting.
You were Vinny Chase?
I was not. I was not.
There we go.
I actually was not fasting. I was, I hadn't drank in a while. I was trying to cut some weight.
Gotcha.
And that
and then
Mexican
boom.
Tequila, next thing I know, I'm drinking. Uncle Wes passed me a shot of Grand Marnier. And I just remember, laying on Rudy Gay because I was about to throw up, and I remember Pete Myers and Uncle Wes drove me back to my room on a golf cart, and they dropped me off in my room. Didn't take anything out of my pockets or anything. So.
That's a
classy dude. So when I woke up the next morning, you know, they had church service and all that, and
you made it to church?
Oh no, I didn't make it to church.
I was gonna say,
washed away all the sins.
But
of the night.
I made it to the brunch. I heard it was a great service.
I missed church when I got to the food.
Shout out to Laura. When I walk in, everybody's like, "Hey, look who's alive!
Look who made
it!" Even like the workers were like, "Hey, buddy, you're okay." I'm like, "Bro, it was really that crazy." Oh yeah, you were out of it. Like,
wait, do you remember the wedding? Like,
yeah, I remember
from being the drunk part. Do you remember?
Yeah, do you remember the golf cart at all?
Nope.
Not kind of, because I was like, bro, where am I going? I was like, did the cartel get me?
Like,
you know what I'm saying? But I gave one of the top 5 speeches of all time.
We want to ask
Andre's wedding?
At Andre's wedding.
Let's hear this.
I was fortunate enough to be one of his
groomsmen.
Best, something like that. I don't know. When he first asked me to be in his wedding, I was kind of like, that's kind of soon. We just met. Like, you know what I'm saying?
But you like me that much?
No. But at the same time, Dre's always been like a brother to me. So the most flattering. That's flattering.
That's about the nicest thing you can
do. Yeah, no, of course. So I thought, you know, Dre always jokes around so much. So I'm like, fam, you don't like, so you want to be, I feel like he's like, do you want to be a best man? I was kind of like, wait,
you were the best man?
Stop, Mustafa.
There were a few.
I'll say it was Slash. There was only four people in the wedding. So it was and Mustafa. But, like, I was, like, 25. That's, like, a big, big deal. I was kind of, like, 10. I'm, like, bro, you sure you want me to be a best? I might fuck the wedding up. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. You want me to be the best, man.
Are you sure?
But I said, no, I'll definitely be a groomsman. I'll definitely say a speech, all that. Yeah. I'm fortunate enough to be the godfather to his daughter.
Oh,
and everything.
Wow.
Yeah, so, little Evan. He named her Evan and everything.
Stop.
Yeah.
After you?
Yeah, that's what it seems like, right?
Oh my gosh!
Yeah.
Wait, this is
we're dying right now.
I know. I'm an amazing person. To say the least.
But I mean, 2K,
everything except like an entourage.
Can't be perfect.
But this, I'll tell you that story. So I'll tell you two different stories. So definitely, I said I was in a wedding. I said a speech. Obviously, I couldn't hold my liquor. Clearly, I'm straight edge. So Dre, you know, he tells me he's having a, you know, him and Christina's sweetest. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm having a daughter, whatever. And so we got the name. I'm like, what is it? And he's like, oh, it's going to be Evan Noel. So in my head, I'm like, Evan Noel. So I was like, Evan Noel, that's crazy. Like, you know, I'm kind of like, I'm super like.
You didn't get it at first.
No, I got it. But like, I'm, you know, I try for them type of moments. I'm like, bro, there's no way he thinks that highly of me. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
Evan Noel, you know, kind of being modest. Maybe just like the name Evan. Maybe I'm just taking too much credit for it. You never know.
I don't think so.
No. You never know. So obviously we were during the season and everything, and we were like traveling and stuff. So when she was born, I couldn't be there. So I didn't see her till she was like 5 or 6 months. I obviously sent my gifts and everything. Yeah. So I'm still like, if you know Iguodala, he's the biggest prankster. So I'm like, bro, I don't believe this baby's name is Evan. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I do not believe.
The whole time you weren't sure.
No, yeah, because Dre will do stuff like that to me. If you know Iguodala, like, fall asleep in front of me, takes pictures of you.
Yes.
Nut taps you. Like, you know, that type of stuff. She's a big ass kid. So I go do yoga with him last year before we played him or whatever. And I remember I remember little Dre was with him. So we go to the bathroom. I'm kind of like, man, here goes my chance to ask him. And I'm like, hey, little Dre, how you doing? He's like, smooth, just chilling out. Man, how's your sister doing? Like, good. I was like, man, I got to ask him. Hey, is her name Evan? Yeah, after you and everything. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm like,
oh my gosh. That's legit.
Well, you know what I'm saying?
That is
but
so
nah,
cool.
No,
you wanted to cry.
No, it's legit. Iggy's like one of my mentors, one of my idols. So like when it comes down to it, like as highly as I think of him, just not even as a basketball player, but as a person. Legit, legit person, caring person, one of the best people I ever met. So like when it comes down to it, you almost don't feel like worthy in a sense, because it's like, brother, this dude is like, to me, like a superhero.
Totally.
You know what I'm saying? So fortunate enough to have that bond and see him win championships, and when he's at his biggest moments or whatever else, you know, when we were in Cleveland last year and stuff like that, he won the championship, like, call him, like, yo, where you at? Like, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, like, that's something. You don't really get that many bonds with people,
that's
especially
so cool.
in this type of industry where people are hating or whatever else. So, that's always
like
a blessing.
Have that genuine connection.
Yeah, it's definitely a blessing. So, that was dope.
That is awesome.
Who's your best friend in the league besides him?
Iggy? Besides Iggy? Man, I've been fortunate enough to have some pretty good bonds with people. I'm obviously on the team. I'm pretty tight with Dame, CJ, Mo Harkless, Chief.
You and Nurk have a fun little friendship.
You know, of course. I try to have great, you know, relationships with them. My dude, Kelly Olynyk, that's my guy. You know what I'm saying? We had a definitely close bond. Drew Holiday, my brother. Mm-hmm. I love him to death. Spencer Hawes.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah Thomas is my G. That's my guy. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But those are some of the people I was super, super tight with. But, you know, somebody that I've had like the most interactions in that sense with, probably as a man and stuff like that, it's probably Iguodala for sure.
Yeah.
So probably for sure. That's, you know, we talk all the time. It's my bro.
What do you feel about, you know, some people don't like the friendships that translate to the court? Like, some people don't like, you know, at the end of the game when you're hugging people and being or helping your friends, like, you know what I'm trying to say? People don't like that, not feeling like a rivalry all the time on the basketball court. Like, what would you say to that?
I just think you really have to approach it as what it is when you're on the court, you're competing. And I feel like the best way to show respect is by trying to kick, you know what I'm saying, kick their ass in a sense. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I think sometimes it's a maturity level too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So when it comes down to it, when the game is over, Oh, yeah, shout out Lou Will. That's my man, too. That's one of my best friends.
Yeah,
too. But,
don't forget Lou.
When a game is over, that's it. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of like with boxing. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, when it comes down to it, you guys threw your blows. That's it. The best man won. And you just leave it at that. You know what I'm saying? I would be upset if that carried over something as dumb as basketball gets in the way of it.
You know, yeah, I mean, like, how everyone was mad when, like, LeBron helped Chris Paul instead of Rondo.
No,
I kind of understood it,
but then at the same time, when it comes to the heat of it, and, you know, and it's going, I thought about that the other day, it's going to go back and look like LeBron and probably Rondo just met each other. What was it, 5 games in?
It's probably just instinct. Like,
I would do that. Help my friend. You wouldn't be thinking about the jersey.
It's probably instinct. I don't know. Like, I'm pretty sure relationship is pretty tight or whatever else. Like, I think that was probably, besides breaking up, which he should have. Mm-hmm. I think that was probably the best thing he possibly could have done in a sense, because, you know, somebody tried to swing on Dre. At the end of the day, like, would I sit there and be like, hey.
But you're not on my team.
I would move him back or whatever else. But, you know, when it comes down to it, like, that's just a whole, you know, just a whole shit show. And even, if, you know, I don't even think LeBron even had a chance to even. He grabbed the first person he probably saw. I think it was instinct for him to do it. They took Rondo off the court right away. And it just wasn't, you know, there was nothing great to come from that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Even though, it was great. It was crazy to see.
Oh, my God. I was there.
Oh, you were there?
Insane.
Oh, it was man, right it was after crazy,
it
man.
Was there. Like, the craziest thing to me, so fight's going on or whatever. You see Chris Paul walking off. He's randomly talking to Floyd Mayweather about the flight on the sideline. He's talking like to Floyd. What? Obviously, Nipsey gets up. Travis Scott gets up. It's just an insane scene. But then I turn to the left and Metta World Peace or Ron Artest, depending on how you're feeling, walks up. And he's giving the media like a play-by-play of the fight.
Oh, of course. He's like, did y'all see that uppercut? So funny.
You see that left hand?
Oh, my gosh.
And I'm like, this is insane. But then 2 minutes later, I'm walking. Charles Oakley's there. So it was.
Oh, that's right. I saw that later.
It was just NBA like pipe dream.
No, not only that, it was the calmest person was like Lance Stephenson.
Which is hilarious.
Which is crazy. But then also, too, I thought, I mean, not trying to promote fighting, but shoot. Like, Rondo, if they did like a charity event in a ring, I'm gonna pull up. I spent a lot of money on a McGregor Mayweather fight, but I was spending a hell of money.
Okay,
who would win that?
So exciting.
I'm going with 9. I'm going Rondo easily.
Really?
9 rounds?
I mean, look at the length.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden, Brandon Ingram joins.
Yeah. You gotta look at the length. You got the reach on him. I think. You know, he's in a little bit better shape. Rondo's a natural athlete. Mm-hmm. Rondo can probably break down. Like, Chris Paul's a great mind, but Rondo could probably break down a boxing match in a second. And then I think the anger is there.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, we saw it.
Yeah, I think the anger is there. And Rondo, from what I know, Chris Paul, I don't know him from anything, but I know he's a competitor. I just know Rondo. Stuff like that gets him.
He's just a different breed.
Yeah. I mean, to each his own.
Well, I remember Dame was telling me, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Dame was, you know, obviously Dame's into boxing big time. Yeah. And I swear, I think I remember this correctly. I asked him who would be his, who he thinks would give him the best fight for his money. Is that the right? Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And he said, I believe he said you.
Yeah, he probably really meant I was going to win. But no. Me and Dane, we both watch boxing. Like, we watch fights together. Trying to get him. He's getting deeper and deeper into MMA. But, you know, like, after like my second year in the league, I started, you know, boxing training a lot.
Yeah.
Just, you know, going to the gym. I was sparring a little bit, you know, my first 4 or 5 years in the league. And, you know, we'll hit the punching bag sometimes. We'll act like we're shadow box. And, you know, we just play around in that sense. But we always joked about sparring and stuff, but I don't.
I can't.
It's probably not a good idea.
No, I don't want to see it.
Yeah, it would never. I would never. Dame, I think we love each other enough and have enough respect. It would never ever be more than what just correct. A fun time. Headgear, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That type of stuff. But off season, I'm like 250. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. 245, 250, and Dame is probably like 220. So, but I know for sure Dame is a bad boy. So.
It's not that I'm promoting violence or anything, but one of the reasons that fight with the Lakers was so captivating and exciting is because it actually happened. Like, people will shove. May do a little head.
And then wait for your teammate to pull you back.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and nobody is really trying to fight. I don't care what they say. They'd be like, well, if they won't hold me back, I would have fought. No one is actually trying to fight, but they fought. Like, they connected. Yeah,
I think there's people in the league that will actually fight.
But my thing is, okay, so if you say that, why haven't you fought? Like, that's my only thing.
No. I think legit, like, there are, like, people do get held back in a sense. I think there's certain people, the ones that are always like, there's fake tough guys. And it's like, there's certain people, if you go through their history, a lot of people to walk around, I'm not going to say any names, to walk around and swear they're tough, and he lost every single scuffle ever. Like, legit out of it. And it's like, fam, like, or you see them, like, in the summertime, there's no type of talk like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But the two people who have never claimed to be tough guys got in a fight.
Oh, no, that's, of course.
You know what I mean?
Oh, no. But, hey, I mean, that's when it comes down to it.
I think if you want to fight, you fight.
No, of course. I bet you didn't think Brandon Ingram would fight either. And he
I don't know. Brandon Ingram's about that.
Clearly. He's from North Carolina. North Carolina. But I think, like, sometimes for sure, I don't think – I think a lot of people, their next punch should be their first punch. And that's A-okay because we have a great group of guys, and fight is never the resolve or anything
it's
like
not.
That. No, and you know, you got dudes that are some bad, bad boys, like David West, who just retired. Mm-hmm. Oh. Udonis Haslam. Like, so to say, like, I remember being on court with them and...
You don't mess with David West.
Yeah, but you know... But, I'm scared of David West. Time, like, you remember, like, every time they went to a free throw line, a low-key be like, hey, square off. And the only reason why they didn't... Stuff would get in between. And it's like, to say that, like, they don't want to fight, it's like, I felt that tension.
Yeah.
Well, I guess I'm more so saying it has to be a perfect storm. Like, both of the people have to fight. Maybe David West always want to fight, but the person didn't want to fight him.
Oh, no.
This was the time where it was like, Rondo wanted to fight and Chris Paul wanted to fight.
Absolutely.
And I don't think that happens very often.
Oh, no, absolutely. And I don't think you should come to we get judged way differently than other people. Like, a hockey fight, that was a great night. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. A baseball fight, that was a great night. And unfortunately, basketball players, the narrative's starting to change a bit, but with basketball players, if we get in an argument, the first thing they say is thugs.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I get into a scuffle last year defending my teammate who got pushed by two or three different people. Next, naturally, I have to do something. I'm going off the court just to... I don't know what I did. I had to use a bathroom or something.
You do that a lot.
I go off the court, people, you're a thug. And it's like, a thug? Like, say what you really mean.
Then,
like, I'm the furthest thing from a thug. Like, you know what I'm saying? So when it comes down to it, I think we get penalized three or four, you know what I'm saying, way tougher than.
Unfairly.
Yeah,
it's the perception of it, which isn't fair. Yeah.
And most importantly, messes up your money.
Yeah. And there's a lot of underlying things to that. I mean, that's one thing I will say, and something I always talk about, is race has always been prevalent in sports. People try to act like right now it's this thing we're talking about all the time.
No,
it's always been the same. It's just discussed more.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it's a lot of, I think, code words. It's a lot of very, like, it's a racial bias, and it's like an implicit bias. You're not always realizing why they're saying thug.
Yeah.
But it's because you're like, well, this is what it looks like when you're fighting, and this is what it looks like when the hockey players are fighting.
I know, of course. Yeah, it takes 27 punches to knock somebody out. Like, you know what I'm saying? But, like, I think not even play devil's advocate. I think sometimes even I've been at the point where there's words and things that come off as insensitive where I don't think sometimes people either care to change that narrative or they don't really know.
Give me an example.
I mean, you can say thug and it's like, yo, to me, like, you can call it thug or that's might be what they might have been trained to say or naturally what is said. And it's like, yo, I can tell my friend, like, yo, stop saying that type of stuff. That sounds ignorant. That sounds like you're categorizing me, because some of the people I've met or some of the people I know that have gotten into a situation or some of the smartest people you'll ever meet come from great backgrounds, do great things for people. And it's like to be categorized as that is nothing.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's not the right way to go about it, especially if you go to a baseball game or go to a hockey game and you got guys that are bruisers and you know, enforcers are just waiting for a fight.
Right.
You dig what I'm saying? And you know, we might, you know, certain guys, again, it's scuffles or whatever, might be the most religious person, and you might look into a different sport, and these people are out drinking, going crazy on, you know what I'm saying?
So I mean, and that's what sucks. But I think we're bringing light to it, though. Situations.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Like, that's life.
No, no, absolutely.
You know, whatever situation you put yourself in, somebody is going to look at that snippet and then say that it's you.
No, absolutely.
Which is why we always have to be so conscious of the things that we're doing, and that's probably why you guys don't fight, because you're going to be judged off of that one moment all the time.
And you know, the NBA is definitely, you know, we have a standard to the league. You know, you can never have that malice in the palace. You know what I'm saying? You can never. Because there's no place for it. There's no. You come to a basketball game to hoop. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And once you hit over 18, the only thing that happens when you fight is you end up dead or in jail.
Yeah. Period.
You know what I'm saying? And that's. And at the end of the day, that's not the way you. Obviously, things come down to it, but that's not the way you handle your problems. You know what I'm saying? And that's just God honest truth. You know?
Yeah. Quick question. What time's your bus?
Oh, shit. What time is it?
It's 10.
Oh, I got to get up out of here, Taylor.
I know. I just making sure. Is it 10:15?
Yeah, it's 10:15. Taylor, you got to get up out of here, too. It's 10:04.
I can't believe it already is 10 a.m.
Yeah, well, when you hang out with me and Brooke, the time just goes
by. It's just so much fun.
We've been around each other for almost 3 years. It felt like.
No, are you kidding me? Six.
Oh, no, I'm saying. No. Well, I'm not including Indy. Indy, I was a completely different person. True. So I don't count that.
Like, I see. You were still. No, you
had a good way or a bad way?
I was growing as a man.
You were transitioning to manhood.
I was transitioning.
That's where I met you. It wasn't a blink.
It was an indie?
Yes, it was an indie.
We figured it out, guys.
Because I'm like really good friends with Rob Laycock.
There you go.
Yes, that's what it is.
Oh, Rob Laycock. Did not think we'd be talking about Rob Laycock on this podcast. What happened? Today.
That's what it is. Okay. That's what it is. Yeah,
thank you so much for being with us.
No, of course. No, this was
a delight.
Fun.
No, it's definitely dope. No, Taylor, really appreciate it. Most people. You know, like I said, we met 12 hours ago. We brought it up.
It's awesome.
Yo, you should do this. And legit, honestly, like, you don't know me from Adam, but I would go out my way and do something like that for somebody. So it definitely, we definitely.
Back to our connections and relationships.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, we definitely appreciate it. Like I said, like, you came here at 8:50 a.m. and
anytime.
Moved your schedule around, did stuff. Like, as soon as we mentioned it, you're like, yeah. And we really appreciate it. And that's.
So see, now all of our mutual friends will know, like, I'm the cooler friend, I'm the better friend.
No, of course, now you have potential amongst our mutual friends to be cool. I'm like, yeah, I guess she's dependable. She'll show up.
As long as there's toast and grapefruit juice.
Yeah, of course.
So shout out to you for the breakfast.
Yeah, well, me and Brooke, we just try, like I said, we try to set the standard. So when it comes down to it, just let everybody know we give out snacks.
We do. And as we get bigger, even better things will come.
Yeah, we'll give out gifts probably. We'll give out, you know, everybody likes Starbucks. We'll give out Starbucks. Gifts and, you know, trips to a Blazers.
Yes.
Jeez, we're getting big time now.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Taylor.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. You guys are a joy.
Thank you. And E.T., go get on that bus.
Oh, yeah,
and what a game tonight, okay?
Yeah.
All right, guys.
No, absolutely. Oh, yeah, we play tonight.
I know. Yeah, you play tonight. All right, guys. Thank you so much for joining us on Road Trippin', and we will see you next time.